holiday tips and fun facts from Paul, Kristen, and Dexter at Total Wine & More.
The custom of bumping glasses with the cheers came from Old Rome. When in Rome, cheers!
A pork crown roast with cranberry stuffing deserves a ripe, fruit-forward Cabernet from Paso Robles. Let me help you find the perfect bottle.
Looking for the right wine for a meaningful gift? Consider me your wine concierge.
Whether you're entertaining or just bringing the wine, we'd love to share our always low prices and ridiculous selection with you. This holiday, now offering same-day delivery at TotalWine.com. Cheers! Holiday tips and fun facts from Paul, Kristen, and Dexter at Total Wine & More.
The custom of bumping glasses with the cheers came from Old Rome. When in Rome, cheers!
A pork crown roast with cranberry stuffing deserves a ripe, fruit-forward Cabernet from Paso Robles. Let me help you find the perfect bottle.
Looking for the right wine for a meaningful gift? Consider me your wine concierge.
Whether you're entertaining or just bringing the wine, we'd love to share our always low prices and ridiculous selection with you. This holiday, now offering same-day delivery at TotalWine.com. Cheers!
We are taking ownership of our narrative, leading the conversation, enlightening our listener. Africa Business Radio. Toward a profitable Africa.
Ladies and gentlemen, welcome on board the flight that takes you from stricken to straightened. We are seconds from takeoff. We ask that you please fasten your earpiece into your eardrum and please log on to AfricaBusinessRadio.com to avoid being distracted. Thank you for choosing Africa Business Radio. Enjoy this cerebral journey.
A celebrity once said, "I gave you all of me, but it's still not enough to make you happy. I gave you everything, but still don't measure up. It's like I walked 5,000 miles, but didn't even come close. It feels like I try to make you smile, but you don't even care. I try to show you that I'm strong. Why do I even bother? It feels like I'm reaching for the skies, but heaven isn't letting me. I wish I had longer arms, but I know that will never be. I'll never be big enough to pay your dues, but I keep trying. You just keep making me jump through hoops. What do I have to do?" "I just want you to look at me and see that I can be worth your love. I just want you to look at me and see that I can be good enough." These words are striking, and are the thoughts of someone stricken. Anyone can be stricken. Cancer is the name given to a collection of related diseases. In all types of cancer, some of the body's cells begin to divide without stopping and spread into surrounding tissues. This can occur almost anywhere in the human body, which is made up of trillions of cells. For example, the breast, the prostate, the lungs, the liver, the duodenum, etc. Normally, human cells grow and divide to form new cells as the body needs them. Old or damaged cells die, and new cells take their place. The breakdown of this orderly process is how cancer develops. So, cells become more and more abnormal. Old or damaged cells survive when they should die, and new cells form when they are not needed. These extra cells can divide without stopping and may form growths called tumors. Now, many cancers form solid tumors, which are masses of tissue. However, cancer of the blood, such as leukemia, generally do not form solid tumors. Cancerous tumors are malignant, which means they can spread into or invade nearby tissues. In addition, as these tumors grow, some cancer cells can break off and travel to distant places in the body through the bloodstream, the circulatory or the lymph system, and they form new tumors far from the original tumor. Unlike malignant tumors, benign tumors do not spread into or invade nearby tissues. Benign tumors can sometimes be quite large. However, when removed, they usually don't grow back, whereas malignant tumors sometimes do. Unlike most benign tumors elsewhere in the body, benign brain tumors can be life-threatening. Now, you may be wondering, what cancer has got to do with mental health and mental well-being? Well, due to popular demand and requests from listeners, we have had to do this special edition on Delirium. For more on this, it's time for Stricken, your favorite weekly show, the show where we decipher how a combination of everyday factors could strike a person and affect their mental well-being. The show where we also seek to connect those that are stricken to practical solutions that will improve their symptoms and mental well-being with little or no clinical intervention. I'm Ahmed Balaji, a mental health first aider and a lawyer. I will be taking you through the journey from stricken to straightened. As with our show, and under the fair use doctrine, we will be greatly assisted by various resources from experts, victims, and survivors on the subject matter. You could be somewhere else, but you chose to be here with us, and we appreciate that. If you love what we're doing and you're enjoying the show, you can join the journey, connect with us, and support us using WhatsApp numbers +234905243117 and +44750864837. On Instagram, Facebook, and LinkedIn at Africa Business Radio, and on Twitter at Africa Biz Radio. We will be right back after this break. When we return, we will together explore cancer and its connection to mental health and mental well-being. In the meantime, here is some information from David Currow, PhD of Flinders University, Adelaide, Australia, courtesy VJ Oncology. After that, take a listen also to Delirium Awareness, courtesy Dementia Together, NI.
Delirium raises an issue right across the spectrum of cancer treatment. Anyone who's acutely unwell is at much greater risk of being acutely confused. Certainly late in life we see this more frequently, but all people being treated for cancer or living with cancer are at greater risk than the population at large. I think we need to have a high index of suspicion when people's cognition has changed. The majority of people with cancer will have a hyperactive delirium, but the person sitting quietly in their bed may well have a hypoactive delirium. We need to have an index of suspicion in order to recognise it, and having recognised it, we need to look for reversible causes. This is an incredibly disturbing issue for patients because the majority of patients, as they clear their delirium, have vivid recollection of their delirium, including the hallucinations. So we need to look at the list of things that we can reverse. Infections, metabolic changes, the drugs that people are already on that may need to be adjusted as a result of their cancer or its treatment. We need to be active in looking for these things so that we can provide good support for people in this frightening experience. We see lots of people with delirium who have reversible causes. I think the most obvious would be a urinary tract infection in someone who is having chemotherapy and became somewhat neutropenic. The challenge is recognising it early, treating it aggressively so that we're supporting people, making sure that the environment in which we nurse that person is supportive. That is, that we look at day and night, we ensure that that is a high priority, we orient the person, we provide a safe environment for them, because if they are hallucinating, those hallucinations are very real, and we need to ensure that we're minimising any potential harm to that person. The bottom line for delirium is have an index of suspicion. Think about the very sick patient. They're at high risk of delirium, and that delirium will not only cause problems while they experience it, but the majority of people are going to remember it afterwards, and it's a frightening experience with a reality that's really quite overwhelming.
Delirium is a medical emergency and can affect anyone. However, certain people are more at risk than others. Those at risk include people over 65, people with a dementia diagnosis, people with infections, and people with a fractured femur. Delirium is indicated by a sudden change in a person's behavior. There are two types. Hyperdelirious, the person is agitated or maybe having hallucinations. Hypodelirious, the person becomes withdrawn. There can also be a mix of the two behaviors. This unexplained change is very disturbing for family and carers. Meet Frank. Frank is an active, independent gentleman of 71 who is currently living alone. Every morning, Frank's daughter Kate calls in for a coffee and a chat. This morning, however, Frank just isn't himself. He's refusing to eat his breakfast and keeps mumbling about his food being poisoned. After 2 days of this changed behaviour, Frank has been admitted to hospital. He won't answer the medical staff's questions and keeps trying to leave. He is anxious and withdrawn. Kate tries her best to pacify Frank, but he is increasingly agitated. He refuses to eat or drink for staff and has started hallucinating about rats on the ceiling of the room. The doctor informs Kate that Frank has a chest infection, but Kate doesn't think this explains his behaviour. She tells medical staff that her father doesn't normally act like this. The nurse treating Frank believes that Frank's infection may have led to him developing delirium. He explains this to Kate. What were the delirium signs? 1. Frank's behaviour had changed suddenly. 2. His daughter said it was out of the ordinary. 3. Frank had an infection. Frank begins to feel better as his delirium is treated. Medication is given to fight his infection, and Kate helps with his food and drink. Delirium causes a rapid change in the person's behaviour. You may notice that they are confused, agitated, delusional or hallucinating, or tired or withdrawn. If you spot any of these signs and symptoms, or if you suspect delirium, please don't be afraid to tell someone. Together, we can make a delirium difference.
Welcome back. If you missed our previous shows, please visit www.africabusinessradio.com/podcast/35. You can also follow me on Instagram at @ASB_stricken. We have set up a non-judgmental, confidential WhatsApp support group for all of you that want to share your experiences and tap into our support network. Message me on WhatsApp number +447508648367. And indicate you want to join the group. There is the option of private messaging to access support on issues you don't want to share with the group. You would remember in our previous episodes on depression that we mentioned it can also be an indicator of other illnesses, be one of the side effects of other illnesses, or even be brought on as the side effects of medication for an illness. For example, cancer. Such is the case for cancer. Did you know that delirium is one of such mental health issues and is a common problem for people with advanced cancer or those at the end of life? It is a mental confusion, a cognitive impairment disorder, and is responsible for how a person thinks, remembers, or reasons. This illness can cause sudden changes in a person's consciousness or state of arousal, such as feeling drowsy or agitated. Those with the condition may experience confusion, disorientation, an inability to focus, memory problems, or changes in perception and behavior, which can include hallucinations or experiencing events that are not really happening. Because of its troubling symptoms, delirium is often very stressful for the person with cancer and his or her family members, as it can make it harder for the healthcare team to assess and manage the person's other symptoms. It can also interfere with the patient's ability to receive cancer treatments. Delirium is a confused mental state that can occur in patients who have cancer, especially advanced cancer. It may come and go during the day. Patients with delirium have problems with attention, thinking, awareness, behavior, emotions, judgment, memory, muscle control, sleeping and waking. Now, there are three types of delirium. You have the hypoactive one, where the patient is not active and seems sleepy, tired, or depressed. You've got the hyperactive delirium, where the patient is restless or agitated. And then you've got the mixed one, where the patient changes back and forth between being hypoactive and hyperactive. The symptoms of delirium usually occur suddenly, that is, it's acute. They often occur within hours or days and may come and go. Delirium is often temporary and can be treated and actually even reversed. However, in the last 24 to 48 hours of life, delirium may be permanent because of problems like organ failure. Most advanced cancer patients have delirium that occurs in the last hours to the days before they die. Delirium may be caused by cancer, cancer treatment, or other medical conditions. It is important to know the risk factors for delirium. It's often more than one cause of delirium in a cancer patient, especially when the cancer is advanced and the patient has many medical conditions. For example, causes of delirium could include organ failure, such as kidney or liver failure. Could include electrolyte imbalances. Electrolytes are important minerals, which include salt, potassium, calcium, and phosphorus, which are in the blood and body fluids. These electrolytes are needed to keep the heart, kidneys, nerves, and muscles working the way they should. Another cause of delirium might be infections or paraneoplastic syndromes, which are symptoms that occur when cancer-fighting antibodies or white blood cells attack normal cells in the nervous system by mistake. Side effects of medication and treatments. For example, patients with cancer may take medications with side effects that include delirium and confusion. These effects usually go away after the medication is stopped. Also, another cause could be withdrawal from medicines that depress, that is, slow down the central nervous system, like the brain and spinal cord. It's important, very important, to know the risk factors for delirium, because patients with cancer are likely to have more than one risk factor for delirium. Identifying risk factors early may help prevent delirium or decrease the time it takes to treat it. Risk factors include the following: serious illness, having more than one disease, old age, dementia, low level of albumin, that's some protein in the blood which is often caused by liver problems, infection, high level of nitrogen waste products in the blood which is often caused by kidney problems, taking medication that affect the mind or behavior, taking high doses of pain medicines such as opioids. The risk increases when the patient has more than one risk factor. Older patients with advanced cancer who are hospitalized often have more than one risk factor for delirium, and the effects of delirium on the patient, family, and healthcare providers are such that it causes changes in the patient that can upset the family and caregivers. Delirium also may affect physical health and communication. Delirium may be dangerous to the patient if his or her judgment is affected. Delirium can cause the patient to behave in unusual ways. Even a quiet or calm patient can have a sudden change in mood or become agitated and need more care. Delirium can be upsetting to the family and caregivers. When the patient becomes agitated, family members often think the patient is in pain, but this may not be the case. Learning about differences between the symptoms of delirium and pain may help the family and caregivers understand how much pain medication is needed. Healthcare providers can help the family and caregivers learn about these differences. Because delirium may affect physical health and communication, patients with delirium are more likely to fall, sometimes unable to control their bladder and bowels, and they are more likely to become dehydrated because they drink too little water to stay healthy. They often lead a longer hospital stay than patients without delirium. The confused mental state of these patients may make them unable to talk with family members and caregivers about their needs and feelings. It could make them unable to make decisions about their care. This makes it harder for the healthcare providers to assess the patient's symptoms. The family may need to make decisions for the patient. Now, possible signs of delirium include sudden personality changes, problems thinking, and unusual anxiety or depression. The symptoms of delirium are a lot like symptoms of depression and dementia. Physical exams and other laboratory tests are used to diagnose the causes of delirium. However, when the following symptoms occur suddenly, there may be signs of delirium: agitation, not cooperating, changes in personality or behavior, problems thinking, problems paying attention, unusual anxiety or depression. Please note, the symptoms of delirium are a lot like the symptoms of depression and dementia. Early symptoms of delirium are like symptoms of depression and dementia. Delirium that causes the patient to be inactive may appear to be depression. Delirium and dementia both cause problems with memory, thinking, and judgment. Dementia may be caused by a number of medical conditions, including Alzheimer's disease. Differences in the symptoms of delirium and dementia can include often show of changes in how alert or aware the patient is. Patients who have dementia will usually stay alert and are aware until dementia becomes very advanced. Delirium occurs suddenly within hours or days, whereas dementia appears gradually over months to years and gets worse over time. Older patients with cancer may have both dementia and delirium. This can make it harder for the doctor to diagnose the problem. If treatment for delirium is given and the symptoms continue, then diagnosis is more likely dementia. Checking the patient's health and symptoms over time can help diagnose delirium and dementia. Doctors will try to find causes of delirium by using physical exam and history. For example, an exam of the body to check general signs of health, including checking for signs of disease such as lumps or anything else that seems unusual. A history of the patient's health habits, past illnesses, including depression and treatments, will also be taken. A physical exam can help rule out physical condition that may be causing symptoms. Laboratory tests are also used, where medical procedures that test samples of tissue, blood, urine, or other substances in the body. These tests help to diagnose disease, plan and check treatment, or monitor the disease over time. Now, treatment of delirium could include looking at the causes and symptoms of delirium. Treatment without medication can also help relieve symptoms. Treatment may include medication, and also sedation may be used for delirium at the end of life or when delirium does not get better with treatment. Both the causes and the symptoms of delirium may be treated. Treatment depends on the following: where the patient is living, such as home, hospital, or nursing home; how advanced the cancer is; how the delirium symptoms are affecting the patient; the wishes of the patient and family. Treating the causes of delirium usually includes the following: stopping or lowering the dose of medication that causes delirium, giving fluids to treat dehydration, giving drugs to treat hypercalcemia, there's too much calcium in the blood, and giving antibiotics for infections. In a terminally ill patient with delirium, the doctor may treat just the symptoms. The doctor will continue to watch the patient closely during treatment. Now, controlling the patient's surroundings may help with mild symptoms of delirium. The following may also help. Keeping the patient's room quiet and well lit, and put familiar objects in it. Put a clock or a calendar where the patient can see it. Have family members around. Keep the same caregivers as much as possible. Patients who may hurt themselves or others may need to have physical restraints. Now, medication may be used to treat the symptoms of delirium, depending on the patient's condition and heart health. These medications have serious side effects, and the patient will be watched closely by a doctor. The medicines may include haloperidol, olanzapine, risperidone, lorazepam, midazolam, and etc. Sedation may be used for delirium at the end of life or when delirium does not get better with treatment. Now, when symptoms of delirium are not relieved with standard treatments and the patient is near death, in pain, or has trouble breathing, other treatment may be needed. Sometimes medication that will sedate the patient will be used. The family and healthcare team will make this decision together. The decision to use sedation for delirium may be guided by the following. The patient will have repeated assessments by experts before the delirium is considered to be refractory. That means doesn't respond to treatment. The decision to sedate the patient is reviewed by a team of healthcare professionals and not made by one doctor. Temporary sedation for short periods of time, such as overnight, is considered before continuous sedation is used. The team of healthcare professionals will work with the family to make sure the team understands the family's views and that the family understands palliative sedation. Now, palliative sedation would mean sedation to relieve the symptoms without dealing with the cause of the condition. The show continues after this break. Don't change the dial.
Confusion is the same as delirium. Confusion is a change in the way you see the world and react to the world. And delirium is acute confusion. So it's a sudden change. One minute you're with it, you're talking to a person, you're making sense. The next minute you're looking over their shoulder, you're looking at the ceiling, you can't even attend to what they're asking for 2 or 3 seconds. It's that sudden change and they're not making sense. Some people say they're away with the fairies. They're out of their tree. It's any of those descriptions, but they're very different to what is normal. Delirium is acute. It's the sudden onset of confusion. It's associated with an inability to relate to the outside world. It's associated with people not being able to hold on to a concept for more than a couple of seconds. It's often associated with hallucinations. So they're looking round. They can't attend to what they're doing. It's sudden onset. Dementia, on the other hand, is a slow, gradual impairment in a person's memory, in their thinking, in their behaviour, in their personality. It comes on over years. Delirium comes on over hours. That's the difference. A delirium is a medical emergency. We don't actually know exactly what's happening in the brain, but clearly there are major things going wrong. It's a cholinergic deficit, so a deficit of acetylcholine, but it stops the brain functioning. People die from delirium. People become disabled after delirium. They spend longer in hospital if they have a delirium. It's a very dangerous condition to have, and so we try and avoid it. There are a number of ways you can avoid delirium. The first thing is to be aware it will happen. So if someone has dementia, we say if they are unwell, expect a delirium. What you can do is make sure the person is well hydrated, that they eat, that they keep mobile, that they're not given drugs that are going to make them worse, that they've got their spectacles, they've got their hearing aid, and preferably they've got someone who's familiar with them, near them. That sort of orientation makes a huge difference for someone with delirium, particularly, say, after an operation. The treatment of delirium depends on the cause. Part of the treatment is supportive, so managing the person, making sure that they're well hydrated, that they're eating, that they're sitting up in bed and not just lying, doing nothing, and then you look for the cause. There is usually a medical cause to delirium. It could be a bladder infection, could be a change in drugs, it could be drug withdrawal, can be a whole range of things. Low blood oxygen, you treat that, and then you're also treating the delirium. There is a difference between hospital and home in terms of the incidence of delirium. Studies have shown that if you care for people who are very unwell in their homes, the incidence of delirium is less. Because they're in a familiar environment with familiar people, they're often better fed, they're often kept well hydrated, they have to walk to the toilet. It's a better environment for an older person to be in if they're at risk of delirium. If someone has a delirium, they can recover from it quite quickly and go back to almost normal, or they can recover very slowly, or some people don't really recover fully at all. If that happens, they're on their way then to residential care. They can't manage at home any longer. And we know that delirium is a pointer towards the need for residential care, so avoiding it is very important. Risk factors for delirium are being older, being acutely unwell, and having an underlying dementia. Being in hospital is also a risk factor for delirium. Risk factors for dementia are quite different. They're usually lifestyle factors associated with raised blood pressure and cholesterol in midlife, perhaps not enough exercise, and a family history. There's also a large number of cases of dementia that come completely unexplained. When an older person comes into hospital, into the emergency department, we want the staff to think of their mental state as one of their vital signs. So just to screen them for a delirium, and that can be done quite quickly in the emergency department. So you need to think about delirium and then screen for it. That can be done in the emergency department. Now, doing it in the wards should happen at least once a day because people vary, and you can develop delirium in the wards as well, and you can develop delirium particularly post-operatively. So we encourage, again, people to screen, to look for changes in a person's mental state after an operation. There are a number of screening tools that can be used. I think the shorter the better, because people, the staff in emergency departments are really busy anyway. Probably the tool known as SQID, single question in delirium, is the best one. It simply asks, has there been an acute change in this person's mental state in the last few hours? Simple as that. If we ask that of every person that came into the emergency department, we'd be doing well. We've really got to watch anticholinergic drugs with delirium. So these are drugs used sometimes in the treatment of Parkinson's disease. These are drugs like furosemide, which we use for cardiac failure. These are drugs like prednisone, which we use in respiratory failure. So we just have to be aware a lot of our common drugs have an anticholinergic effect. That is, they cause more confusion in an already fragile brain. A story of one of my patients more recently with a dementia who came in and had a hip replacement. She was in recovery after having had a successful hip replacement and unfortunately developed a delirium which was not picked up. She thought she heard her husband being carried off to be executed, climbed over the rails of the bed, fell and completely dislocated her just finished hip replacement. An example where post-operative delirium should have been looked for.
Welcome back to the show. That was Professor Sue Curl of the University of Sydney on the delirium as different to dementia. If you're just joining us, you can catch up on all the episodes of Stricken at www.africabusinessradio.com/podcast/35. You can also follow me on Instagram at ASB_Stricken. We run a non-judgmental, confidential WhatsApp group for all of you that want to share your experiences, ask questions, make suggestions, and tap into our support network. Message me on WhatsApp number +447508648367 and indicate you want to join the group and you will be added. There is the option of private messaging to access support on issues you do not want to share with the group. We can see so far that cancer is not the only factor that could bring about the onset of delirium. Other factors like medication, infection, surgery or operation, alcoholism, and withdrawal from drugs or alcohol could also trigger delirium. It is important to assess delirium in order to be able to adequately and appropriately support the individual, and also to be able to differentiate it from dementia, which although has similar symptoms, but is fundamentally different. Have a listen to Delirium Assessment, courtesy University of Dundee Clinical Skills, following which you should hear the assessment method, which is Confusion Assessment Method by Dr. Joseph Flaherty. This is courtesy Gateway Geriatric Education Center.
We'll explain clinical assessment of delirium using the Confusion Assessment Method, or CAM, and a new delirium screening tool called the 4AT. First, we'll look at the Confusion Assessment Method. The CAM is made up of four items. 1. Acute onset and fluctuating course. 2. Inattention. 3. Disorganised thinking. And 4. Altered level of consciousness. To diagnose delirium with this method, patients must have both 1 and 2, and either of 3 or 4. We'll now go over the assessment of delirium using the CAM through a case study. Mrs. Smith is admitted to the acute medical assessment unit with this GP letter.
Excuse me, are you a doctor?
Yes,
my name's waiting for someone to see my dad, James Smith.
Oh, right, yes, I'm due to see him.
Oh, okay, I'm really worried about him. I really am. I mean, he's been acting very, very strange, and it just came on really suddenly, you know, about Monday, very early Monday morning, heard him clambering about the house.
Right.
And he just seems really confused. He's like wandering around in the middle of the night, sleeping during the day, doesn't really want to eat or drink, and he's saying kind of strange things and stuff. Okay. I just, was hoping somebody could...
Yeah, that's fine. I'll just come and see him just now.
That'd be great.
My name's Dr. Taylor.
Oh,
are you Mr. Smith's doctor?
Yeah,
is that
Jill.
Jill. Great.
Jill,
okay. I'll just come and see him just now. And this has all just been the last couple of days.
Just 2 days or so, yeah.
Okay.
Dad, Pops, yeah. The doctor.
Collateral history is often the best way to get a history of acute onset and fluctuating course. Hello there, Mr. Smith. My name's Dr. Taylor. How are you today?
All right.
You were just in the hospital today, Mr. Smith, because you've been a bit poorly.
Hospital? It's a hospital.
Yeah.
Oh, right. What day is it? What day is it?
This is Wednesday today.
Right. Okay.
Mr. Smith, I'd like to ask you to do something.
Hi.
I'd like you to say the months backwards. So starting in December, and then say the months backwards.
Right. December. Mm-hmm. November.
Inattention is being easily distractible or having difficulty keeping track of what's said. This can be tested both by observation and by specific methods, for example, asking the patient to count through the months backwards as shown. Mr. Smith, can you tell me how you got to hospital today?
The doctor was in my house.
Mm-hmm.
And he was going to take the cats. And the cats were hurt, weren't they? And largest number. My daughter's got 3 cats.
Disorganized thinking can be seen in delirium. For example, rambling, incoherent conversation, an unclear or illogical flow of ideas. It's unpredictable, switching from subject to subject.
I don't know what's going to happen.
Oh no, Pops, it's okay. It's okay. No, it's okay. No. Something just fell, Pops. It's not a problem. It's okay. Just lie back, relax. Come on, Pops, it's okay. It's okay. Just lie back. That's it. The doctor just wants to have a chat. Don't worry, darling. It's just something fell.
Patients with delirium can have altered level of consciousness. This can be either drowsy or hyper-alert and agitated. Beware of drowsy patients, as hypoactive delirium is more commonly missed. To summarise, the CAM is made up of 4 items. 1. Acute onset and fluctuating course. 2. Inattention. 3. Disorganised thinking. And 4. Altered level of consciousness. To diagnose delirium with this method, patients must have both 1 and 2 and either of 3 or 4. We will now look briefly at the 4AT. This is a newer tool which uses a formal score to test for delirium. The features are very similar to the CAM and include alertness, an AMT4, inattention measured by months backwards, and fluctuating course. The total score is out of 12, and a score of 4 and above is suggestive of delirium. In summary, today we've discussed 2 methods for assessing delirium, the short CAM score and the 4AT. Take-home messages are that delirium is acute in onset, fluctuating in course. Patients have inattention and may have altered consciousness. I can see your dad's very confused just now. This is really not like him.
No, what could be wrong with him?
From my assessment, I can see that he has a condition called delirium, okay?
Is that serious?
That's a type of acute confusion, okay? And it's usually a reflection of something else going on, like an infection, okay?
All right.
Delirium can be distressing for everyone to see. The distressing symptoms usually resolve quite quickly, often in about a week.
All right.
It can last a bit longer.
Okay. So he's not going to be like this all the time?
No, we'd expect this to get better.
All right, okay.
I'll give you a bit more information to read about delirium and just ask us if there's any other questions you have. I'm going to go back to assess him to find out what's triggering this and what's making him unwell.
So he's got, like, something wrong with him that's making him act like this, but
yep.
We just can't see what it is.
Yeah. Usually delirium's a reflection of other medical conditions going on.
Okay.
And we need to look for those and treat those, and that should make the delirium get better.
Okay.
The CAM stands for the Confusion Assessment Method. It's a screening tool, and it was developed in order to identify or screen for something called delirium. Delirium is a dangerous diagnosis, as some people would say. And whether we think it's a diagnosis, a syndrome, or a complex of symptoms, whatever you want to call it, delirium is a dangerous diagnosis. Why? Because delirium has very negative outcomes. Increased morbidity as well as mortality. We also think delirium is a dangerous diagnosis because it's easily confused, so to speak, with dementia, which is very different.
Oh, no, I didn't bring him.
Hello, it's folks.
Right. Where is Hi, ma'am. I don't know where he is.
I'm Dr. Flaherty.
Nice to meet you. I'm Sharon Jones, his wife.
Okay, nice to meet you. Mr. Jones? Mr. Jones, I'm Dr. Flaherty. The nurse has asked me to come see you.
Where is Brownie? Where's my dog?
He's okay. I've been here all day. He was fine this morning, and this afternoon it's not going so well.
Okay.
He's not very alert.
I've never met him before. Does he? I read his chart, and he has Alzheimer's, dementia.
That's correct. He's been here about a month.
Oh, okay. Was he ever like this before?
No, not really. He's deteriorated since.
Okay. Let me ask him a couple questions. Mr. Jones, wake up for me. Mr. Jones? Tell me what day of the week this is.
Friday.
That's right. Today is Friday. Now tell me what year this is.
Friday.
Okay. Would he normally get that question?
No, he really wouldn't. He usually goes back to, like, the 1950s, you know, repeats
where's
it all the time.
Where's Brownie?
Don't worry about Brownie. He's fine. Okay. He's at home.
But at least he would say a year. Let me try that one time. But Mr. Jones, what year is this?
I don't know where my dog is. I don't know where he is.
He's at home.
Let me try one more thing. Mr. Jones, if today is Friday, what was yesterday?
Friday.
Okay.
Friday.
If today's Friday, yesterday would be Thursday. What's the day before Thursday?
Saturday.
Okay. Okay. I'm going to try one more. The somnolent or lethargic type of delirium is often the most dangerous type because it's often the most unrecognized or missed type. People can go days, sometimes longer, and just be labeled as sleepy or fatigued. So the confusion assessment method really is objective criteria that helps you diagnose delirium when it first begins.
Tuesday. Saturday.
Good. We're going to try it one more time. Mr. Jones, if today is Saturday, I want you to say the days of the week backwards, starting with Saturday.
Saturday. Friday, Saturday.
Okay. One more thing. I would like to try just one little other test here. I'm going to say some letters, Mr. Jones. When I say the letter A, I want you to raise your hand. A. Okay. Of the somnolent lethargic type of delirium, it's pretty clear once you use the CAM. You get a good history from the wife that something has changed recently. He's fluctuating because the wife says he wasn't like this morning. Okay. You get attention tasks. The attention tasks I do, he cannot complete the attention tasks, so that's inattention. He's disorganized. I don't have to ask specific disorganization questions. I asked him orientation questions, and instead of giving me the wrong year, he gave me a very disorganized answer. He kept on the days of the week or the dog. The hyper-alert or vigilant type of delirium is rarely missed. This person's usually labeled with agitation. But if you look at the clip we're about to see, the patient's eyes are vigilant. He may not be agitated, but his thinking is just vigilant. So it's as important in this type of patient to do the attention tasks, as you'll see. He's able to start it, but his inattention won't allow him to complete the task.
Okay.
Good, good. All right, let me just a couple more questions, and then we'll figure out a way to find Brownie. Tell me what day of the week this is.
Friday.
Right, right. Now tell me what year this is.
Friday.
Okay, okay. One more question, then we'll figure out what to do. I want you to start with Saturday and say the days of the week backwards.
Saturday, mm-hmm. Friday, Saturday, Sunday.
The mixed type is another common type of the three types of delirium. What you'll see in the clip is that during part of the interview, he's more lethargic or somnolent. Then he becomes hyper-alert, and then he trails off during one of the attention tasks. Mr. Jones, I want to try one other thing. I'm going to say a string of letters. When you hear the letter A, Mr. Jones, when you hear the letter A, I want you to raise your hand. A. Good. B. D. T. A. Some patients with delirium may not meet all the criteria for delirium. If they have one or two components, we would call this subsyndromal delirium. We think this has a bad outcome too, because if you don't pick it up early, those people could go on to have full-blown delirium, and again, the medical causes could be overlooked. The clip you're about to see, the patient looks maybe his baseline, except when we do the attention tasks, he's unable to complete them.
I think there's something wrong.
Really? In what way?
He's just not acting the way he normally does.
Physically or more thinking-wise?
Thinking-wise.
Okay. Well, I need to ask you a few questions. Some simple, some a little more difficult. What day of the week is this?
Friday.
Good, good. And what year is this?
1955.
Okay, is that where he is? He's been for a few years?
That's where he's been.
All right. Now do something else for me. I want you to start with Saturday and say the days of the week backwards.
Saturday, Friday, Saturday, Sunday, Monday, Tuesday, Wednesday.
Okay, good, good. Now let's do it this time. Start with Saturday and say the days of the week backwards.
Saturday, Friday, Friday.
I would leave it at this. Delirium is such a dangerous diagnosis, and screening for mental status changes, screening for the possibility of delirium, is so important that mental status should become that sixth vital sign.
Delirium is a dangerous condition and can be distressing for partners, relatives, and friends too. If your partner, relative, or friend is going through an episode of delirium, don't be afraid to support them. Don't stigmatize them. Talk to the relevant health professionals to get support with understanding what is necessary to help them through the episode. Terry McLeod, a CBC radio host, describes his experience with delirium after a heart surgery. Take a listen to Terry's story, courtesy St. Boniface Research, Canada. What was delirium like for you after heart surgery?
Before the surgery, a few days before the surgery, in fact, the medical staff gave me a little handbook, and I think it said on the front, delirium. And I looked at it and thought, well, not going to happen to me. Because, I had done research before the surgery. I was watching open heart surgery online because I really wanted to know what it looked like. I knew they were going to stop my heart. I knew all that stuff that was going to go on. So I thought, boof, I am so totally prepared that this will never happen to me. And then, so my experience of the surgery was tremendous. So I'm back in the intensive care unit, and I wake up, and I begin to think, I can't figure out where I am. And I thought, I'm in a motel in Morden, Manitoba. It's called the Heartland Motel. Don't know why. And I thought, I can't be in a motel. And then I looked across the room, and I was convinced that I saw a car parked there with its headlights on. And I thought, I'm on the fifth floor. There can't be a car parked there, but I have to get out of this hospital. And so I said to myself, I'm leaving. And I looked down, and I'm full of tubes and connected to many things in the bed. And I knew I was just wearing a Johnny shirt. I'm not sure what you guys called them, but it was like an open back thing. No shoes, nothing, just bare feet. And I thought, I don't care. I'm getting out of this hospital. And then when this began to happen, I couldn't understand it. I was upset. I was confused. I mean, it's a good thing I didn't do something stupid like try to pull out some of the IVs and such that were connected to me, because I was really kind of lost.
What did the nursing team do to help?
One of the nurses came by and was trying to pull me back to earth like I was a balloon floating away. The physical contact was helping to pull the balloon back to earth, because I was really gone for some points. Like I was on a very long string, and the balloon was blowing in a very fierce wind.
What was it like for your family to see you in this state?
My wife arrives, and I'm totally righteous with her. Ellen, I got to get out of this place. And my son was there with her, and at that point he was 19. And he really got upset because he had never seen me in this kind of state, and he was afraid, like quite afraid, that I was gone. So he comes to me and says, "Dad, count my fingers." So he's very deliberate with this, helping me to focus on, and he would say to me, "Dad, where are you? What's happened to you? Why are you here? What day is it?" So he went through all that that he'd seen the nurse do with me. And that helped to pull me down and to pull me back to earth. And that made quite a difference for me.
How important is it that patients and caregivers know about delirium?
I had no idea that delirium was even possible. My son, I think, if he was here, he might tell you how frightened he was. Because I was so gone, so not myself. I had no idea that delirium was even possible. I'm a researcher by profession, so I pay a lot of attention to things, but I missed this.
What would you tell other heart surgery patients about delirium?
That's an interesting question. It's certainly important that loved ones know about it, because if they come to visit the person they love in the recovery room, and they're in this kind of a state, to be aware that there is a distortion of perception on the part of the patient, and to be caring about that, to not argue with the person, to not try to talk them out of it, but to connect them to where they are in the time that they're loved. You know me, I'm your wife, I'm your son, we're here, you're getting better, don't worry about it. So that was, I think, really important.
You should consider seeking competent professional advice and support, amongst other measures, for a more personalized assessment, that is, if you feel the need to. The above is not for you to become paranoid. It is for you to be fairly equipped, because you are not alone. Hang in there. There is help around the corner, because you are worth it. You could be anywhere else, but you chose to be with us, and we appreciate that. I'll leave you with this song, My Delirium, performed by Lady Hawk.
Me. I'm going to give him a hero shot.
Until next time, I'm Ahmed Balaji, and this has been Stricken. Thank you for listening.
We are the wind in the sails of your business. We are your compass. Chart your course towards your targets. Africa Business Radio. Towards a profitable Africa.
Holiday tips and fun facts from Paul, Kristen, and Dexter at Total Wine & More.
There are over 1 million bubbles in a glass of champagne. Here's to a whole lot of celebrating.
Did you know Zinfandel is known as America's wine? Serve it with chocolate for an indulgent pairing.
Need a $10 rockin' gift for your office's gift exchange? Let me help you pick the perfect bottle.
Whether you're entertaining or just bringing the wine, we'd love to share our always low prices and ridiculous selection with you. This holiday, now offering same-day delivery at TotalWine.com. Cheers!
Right now, when you come in and switch to T-Mobile, you get the amazing iPhone 11 Pro on us with iPhone XS trade-in.
Aren't these mountains majestic?
Joe, are you even looking?
I'm posting these amazing pics I took with my iPhone 11 Pro. It has three cameras.
Whoa, those pics are amazing. And you have service too?
T-Mobile. Their newest signal goes farther than ever before.
Then you can look up whether these are bear tracks, right?
Or we could just run.
Come to a T-Mobile store today and get iPhone 11 Pro on us with iPhone XS trade-in. And right now, get four lines for just $30 a line with AutoPay. Switch today.
Contact us if you cancel or credits may stop and full price due, plus taxes and fees via 24 monthly credits for well-qualified customers with qualifying service and finance agreement. Zero down with trade-in plus $31.25 times 24 months. Pre-credit price, $999.99. 0% APR while supplies last.